When you move, I know. amazing. Treating my sorrows.
Thank you.
already, Anybody have an idea what that picture is?
Is that the land of Zion?
You look at the picture here, it looks like some of the valleys we have out here.
I know.
Right? But this is a long, far away from us. You'll see the valley here in the center, and it's surrounded by some different sides. This is actually a valley that we read about in the Bible. I'm going to be talking about this valley in a minute, so I just want you to take a picture in your mind of that valley as I'm talking. And you'll see right in the middle where we talk about this army we're going to talk about, we're going to see that a great battle takes place in here, in the center of this area. And the Philistines will be on one side of this valley, and the Israelites are on the other side. And the Philistines are putting pressure on the Israelites. They're teasing them. They're making fun of them. They're pressuring them to make a move. And that's where it happened, right there. We're going to talk about it in just a minute. Anybody recognize this picture? Well, I just want you to know that that picture is actually... I put shorts on them because it wasn't appropriate for church. This is actually Michelangelo's depiction of David before he killed Goliath. That's his depiction. We're going to talk about this today, David and Goliath. And the picture that we see here, minus the shorts, we put that on there because we had to. But that's a little different than what David probably actually looked like when this happened. David was one of the smallest boys in his family. And he was only 15 years old or so. They say 15 when he actually battled Goliath. So this is Michelangelo's picture, but in real life, you can imagine David smaller. He probably looked like a 15-year-old, right? One of the smallest boys there in his life. This is a different depiction of the battle itself, taken from Scripture's description of what it might have looked like. You can see the two actually coming face to face, Goliath and David. You got those pictures in your mind? Okay. I'm going to turn those off, and then we're going to talk about it. That area, and that happening, how it happened. And also, we're going to talk about how it affects you if you're a person who's living, a godly life, how this story should affect you, okay? Keep that in mind here. You probably already know quite a bit about this story, right? You probably already read the story. You know what happens in the end. Goliath is defeated by David. That's the part of the story that you know. This valley where this incident took place, it's one of my favorite places to read about, is this scenario that takes place right there in that valley. I've never seen it, but it'd be something to be there and a picture and imagine it in my head while I'm standing there in the valley. Wouldn't that be something if you were there? Here it happens, a scene of the most famous battle that's described in the Old Testament. And here's what's so interesting about this battle. It's not fought between two armies, but fought between two people. Only two people in the battle. And the armies are on each side of the valley. The Philistines and who?
Israel.
The Israelites, right? There they are, the two. But the battle is just between two people. even people who don't know anything about the Bible or read the Bible know about the story. And they know about this battle. It was fought between David and a giant named Goliath. The chances are you know the story. If you're here or you're watching, you're going to be watching this. You can put this story together already in your head. Now, it's an important story, and I know it. The author really wanted you to know the details. He wanted you to never forget about this story. The author, biblical author of this account. He gave a lot of space to it. For one thing, it consists of 58 verses in the Bible. This story, 1 Samuel chapter 17. 58 verses, and what do those deal with? This battle is what it deals with. Okay. So it's one of the longest chapters in the Bible. It uses 912 Hebrew words, this book of the Bible. It's one of the most detailed descriptions of any battle you're going to find anywhere in the Bible. Descriptive. Detailed. We're told about the location of it. We're told about the weapons that were involved. We're even told about the size of one of the combatants. The author of this story wants to make sure this story would stick out in your soul. The author of this book in the Bible did not want you to forget about it, but he wanted you to remember it because this story can affect you. And I hope that God does a miracle in our hearts while we talk about it today. His name was David, the greatest king who ever lived. And this is one incident of his life, probably the hugest incident of his life, and we're going to talk about it today. He was the most honored king in Israel, and had even his own tomb, David did. The sign of the nation of Israel, even today, is the Star of David. The Star of David. This David. Okay. We're going to be learning a tremendous lesson today about, about taking down the giant today. I guess that would be the takeaway from this whole message today. We're going to learn a huge lesson, and hopefully this will stick with you. It's kind of like a Christmas story, this story. It's one you don't have to really go over much. Everybody knows the story. We could go into the details, but you mostly have already heard the details of the story. Whether you're a kid or an adult, you never get tired of hearing about it. It's like Hollywood, right? This story has everything. Think about it. You have the huge giant that would make the Hulk look like a punk, right? Fighting not a man, but who? A boy. David is about 15 years old. He doesn't even have a driver's license. He can't even, you know, drive his dad's chariot. That's David, little boy. Think of yourself when you were 15. But that's not the picture of David a lot of people have. You remember the picture we looked at? Looked a little bigger, a little more muscular, a little stronger. Realistically, this Bible story makes it clear that David was just a boy, 15 years old. This picture that we've seen earlier was a picture found in Florence, Italy, in the Accademia Gallery. And that's Michelangelo's picture of David. Statue. It's a statue, actually. We showed you a picture here. But it's a towering presence, this statue. It's 14 feet So if you were to go to Italy and see and come before, you'd look up at David, you'd be like, wow. But that's not what you would have done if you were there at this valley that day. You would have looked at David, you'd be like, David, what are you doing? That's what you would have done. Somebody save this boy. I believe this story captures why this was David's finest hour. Why this was his most historical moment. What this really did was it put him in every Christian's mind for life. What we learned from him, not only how we can, you know, go after God's heart, how we can live in such a way that we bring a smile to the face of the Lord and God. But we learn more. We're going to learn how we can face the giant and the challenges and the problems you face. We all have them. So let me just ask you, before we get into this story, I want you to answer your own question. What's your giant? Your giant could be sadness or loneliness. Your giant could be addiction. Could be making a living. You could be struggling. Maybe you've had a death in the family. Whatever the case is, you have a giant. And sometimes facing those giants becomes hard for us. I believe that this story can help us to kill our giants if you're facing one. But you got to pay attention or you'll miss them. The points that are going to help you along the way. Here's the first one. Be focused on God's presence. Be focused on God's presence. At the beginning of the story, Israel is fighting the Philistines, the most hated enemy. The Philistines are on one side of the valley, and the Israelites are on the other side. And the Israelites, they had a giant of a problem. And the problem was a giant. Right? The author of this part of the Bible wants you to know just how big of a giant he was. This was a no-joke giant. He gives us the detailed description of a soldier and a warrior found anywhere in the Bible. Join with me in prayer, and then I'm going to read to you the description, and that will help us to set the stage for where we're at in facing our giants. Pray with me. Dear God, we want to thank you for bringing us together today. Whether we're here or we're going to be watching this in video, we send these out. We pray that your spirit will be with the message, that you do a miracle in our hearts with the message. We leave it in your hands to do with it what you please. In the name of Jesus, we pray. 1 Samuel 17. Let's try that one. Okay, here we go. 1 Samuel 17 is just written in my notes. 17 and verse 4, this is what it says about him. And the Philistines stood on the mountain on one side, and Israel stood atop the mountain on the other side. So they're on the mountain, they're looking at each other. Here's the valley in the middle of them. And there was a valley between them. And there went a champion out of the camp of Philistines named Goliath. A champion. The camp of the Philistines named Goliath of Gath, whose height was 6 cubits and a span. I'll tell you what that is in just a minute. And he had a helmet of brass upon his head and was armed with a coat of mail. And the weight of the coat was 5,000 shekels of brass. And he had greaves of brass upon his legs and a target of brass between his shoulders. And the staff of the spear was like a weaver's beam, and his spear's head weighed 600 shekels of iron. And one bearing a shield went before him. And he stood and cried unto the armies of Israel and said unto them, why are you come out to set your battle to array? Am not I a Philistine, and ye servants to Saul? choose you a man for you and let him come down to me. Set the stage for you? Okay. Let's just talk about this for a minute. A champion named Goliath, he's come down now and then he's challenged them, right? There's a challenge. He's called a champion, which is the only time anyone is ever called a champion, called that name in the Bible, champion. Only time you're going to read that. This man, the Bible says, he's a champion. So he must have been one, right? Must have been good, must have been a champion. Which literally means a man between two armies. He was 9 feet, 9 inches tall. 9 feet, 9 inches tall. 9 feet. Okay? And 9 inches, that means he was almost 10 feet.
That's something.
Right? Okay. So imagine it like a basketball standing still. Just imagine it. He wore this shirt of bronze weighing 175 pounds. That's how much that chest plate he had on him wore was. 175 pounds. He carried a spear whose head weighed 25 pounds. So imagine that long spear. The head alone was 25 pounds. Okay. So you can imagine as a kid, I don't know, he must have been, you know, he must have looked like the teacher in school. You know what I mean? I mean, he must have been huge right from the start. The point is, he was a giant. He had challenged Israel to a one-on-one, mano-a-mano. Here we go. Mano-a-mano. And this had been going on for how long, do you think? How long do you think Philistines were taunting them with, come on, give us your best guy? And here's this giant challenging them, taunting God's people, taunting them. Israelites didn't feel like there was anything they could do. How long do you think that went on? 6 weeks. 6 weeks. They had to sit there and watch this giant teasing them. He'd come out and he'd challenge them, and then he'd go away, and then he'd come back again. He challenged them. Okay. We're told in remember, how many people actually came forward to do it? Anybody come forward?
No.
Before David, right? Nobody, right?
No.
They were looking for volunteers. Anybody want to try it? Nobody came forward. We're told in verse 25 how the king had even tried to bribe someone to fight Goliath. In verse 25 it says, now the Israelites had been saying, do you see how this man keeps coming out? He comes out to defy Israel. The king will give great wealth to the man who kills him. He will also give him his daughter in marriage and will exempt his family from taxes in Israel. So, I mean, if someone felt they could do it, that'd be a pretty good deal, wouldn't it? The man who would kill the giant would instantly be what?
Taxes.
He'd be set, right? He'd be set for life. Wouldn't have to pay any more taxes, right? He'd have his daughter in marriage. He would have instant fortune and fame and be a part of the king's family. But nobody showed up. Why didn't they show up?
They were scared.
Yeah. The only thing they were seeing was
the giant.
Right. Even if they wanted to try it, they'd go and they'd see this giant and they would... The only thing they were seeing is giants. Then David shows up. He'd been sent by his dad to take some food to his brothers and bring them back news on how the war was going. Right? Because there's a standoff now. And he was going to take news back to his dad. Okay. He keep in mind, nobody wanted to go. Nobody wanted to show up. You know, no one wanted to crawl out from under the bed and attack that giant. Everybody was hiding from him. Then David shows up. He's got this task from his, you know, family. Take some food to his brothers. Then David sizes up the situation. And this is what we read. And I want you to remember, these are the first recorded words we hear about David. Isn't it amazing? The first time we hear about David, he's a little boy, and he ends up over here in this area. First time we hear about David, from David, his first words ever recorded, this is what he says. Chapter 26, 17, verse 26. David asked the men standing near him, "What will be done for the man who kills this Philistine and removes this disgrace from Israel? What's going to be done to him? And who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God?" 15-year-old boy. Who is David seeing?
God.
Right from the start, David sees God in all of his glory. Who's everyone else seeing?
The giant.
The giant. What do you see with your giant?
God.
Right? Think about it. How we're going to apply this today for us. So David, really, he says, in other words, see how much bigger he is than we are? That's what they said to David. And David says, do you know how much bigger God is? Right? That's kind of how the conversation's going. They're like, did you see this guy? This guy's huge. He's a giant. And David's like, you know how big God is?
Amen.
Right? Can you imagine the conversation between you guys aren't even thinking about God? Right? He's 15. David says, do you know how much bigger God is than he is? Everybody else was looking at the giant, but David was looking at God. Listen to this. When you face a problem you think you can't solve, if you're facing a problem like that you think you can't solve, an obstacle you do not think you can get over, a giant you don't think you can defeat, fear will focus on what? Fear in the situation is going to focus on what? The giant. Right? Isn't that what we do? Right? I got this situation that I can't get it out of my head. And I'm going to try to solve the situation, but I don't know how I'm going to solve the situation. This is huge for me. And all we see is the situation. Isn't that what happens? If you're watching, right? This is what happens to us. This is our nature. But faith will focus on who?
God.
God. You see the difference between what everyone else was doing and what David walked in and did? David had faith right from the start. He expressed it right here in his conversation with the men. You know, if you read this entire story, you're going to find that David only mentions Goliath how many times in that? Okay, there's 58 verses of the story. How many times does David mention Goliath? You'd have to read the whole thing, right? But if you read the whole thing, you'd read this twice. David only mentions Goliath twice. Isn't that interesting? Like he's not that important. There's something about Goliath and something to Goliath, and both times he calls him with disdain, an uncircumcised Philistine. In other words, this Goliath, he's not worthy to taunt God's people. That's what David was saying. Do you know how many times David mentions God? You'd have to read it to know, but if you start there in the first verse to the 58th verse, 10 times. He mentions God. Who was David seeing?
God.
Right? David talked about God five times more than he talked about the giant. We usually reverse the ratio. We talk more about the problem than we talk about God. That's what we do. Maybe that's what you could be doing now. God was not on their radar screen. God filled David's radar screen. Does that make sense? In their radar screen was giants. In David's radar screen was God. If you want to be someone after God's heart, then the next time you face a challenge, that problem, that difficulty, that giant, whatever it is, then you need to be focused on God's presence. On God's presence. God is with you. Here's the other thing you need to remember when you're faced with a giant. One, recognize God is present. See God. See God over the giant. Two, be fearless in God's power. Be fearless in His power. The good news is there is finally an Israelite who's willing to go out and face the giant and fight the giant. The bad news is it's not a hard battle-tested soldier that wants to do it to face the giant. It's an inexperienced teenage shepherd. That's who shows up to get the job done. And he has never held what? A sword. He's never been in battle. He's never held a sword in his hand. He's never had a shield, and he never wore a helmet before. Here's this kid. This is the first time he has ever seen a battlefield or been in battle. First time. That's who shows up. There he is. Why was David ready to run to the fight when no one else wanted to run? When everyone else wanted to run away from the fight, why was David running right into the fight? What do you think? Why was he running right into the fight? What did he know?
That God was with him.
God was with him. This is what the verse says in the Bible. Saul replied, "You are not able to go out against them and fight. You're a young man. And he has been a warrior from his youth." And David said, this is what David said, the slow boy. "Your servant has been keeping his father's sheep. When a lion or a bear came and carried off a sheep from the flock, I went after it, struck it, and rescued the sheep from its mouth. When it turned on me, I seized it by its hair, struck it, and I killed it. Your servant has killed both lion and bear. This uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them, because he has defiled the armies of the living God." The Lord, this is why he was running to the fight. "The Lord rescued me from the paw of the lion and the paw of the bear, and he will rescue me from the hand of this Philistine." So Saul said to David, "Go, and the Lord be with you." And the Lord be with you. That's incredible that it took a shepherd boy to remind a king and an army of just how powerful God is. Do you know why we fear our giants? Or why we worry too much? Why we quit too easily? And why we run away from them? Do you know why? We forget what we ought to remember. And we remember what we ought to forget. What we remember, we shouldn't be. But what we need to remember, we forget it. We magnify the giant that is before us, and we minimize that God is with us. So the giant is bigger to us than God. That's what we do. God has given us three kinds of sight: hindsight, insight, foresight. We have this ability to look backward, to look forward, and to look inward, right? Inward. The right hindsight will give you the proper insight to have a competent foresight. So David, he could face the present and be unafraid of the future. And it was because he remembered from the past. He was drawing on things he knew. That's what David was doing. He was drawing on things that he knew. With his bare hands and a stick, he had killed a bear and a lion. He was drawing on things he knew. That happened. He realized even then, it wasn't because of his strength, but even with the bear and the lion, where did he get that power?
From God.
He knew that God was caring for him. He knew the power was from God. If you remember what God did for you yesterday, you will believe what he can do for you today. And you'll be confident in what he will do for you tomorrow. David remembered what everybody else had forgotten. Everyone forgot it. The Israelites, they forgot it. David believed in what everybody else doubted. What did he believe that they didn't believe?
That David was going to accomplish to get rid of the guy.
Right.
The giant.
Right. So they didn't believe they had the power.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Okay. Listen carefully if you're watching or you're here today. Listen to this. When you see the God that others don't, you will do for God what others won't if you see the God they don't. Does that make sense? You will do what others will not do because you see God. You see him. You know that God is with you. That God will make you successful. Okay. What David realized is that there's only one giant in life. What does that mean? When you say David realized there's only one giant, what are we referring to? Really, if you're really going to talk about giants, who is the only real giant?
Ourselves.
Well.
Oh, yeah.
Right? So yeah. We're talking about David, Goliath, and God, right? God is the giant. We see God bigger than anything. God is our giant. Okay. It isn't a giant, it is the giant. The trial, the trouble, the temptation, the hardship or tribulation that you're facing may look like a giant to you. It might. It might look like a giant. It might sound like a giant. May feel like a giant. But I'm going to tell you, there's only one giant. There's only one. And Satan will have you thinking that you're facing the one. Okay? With hardship, tribulation, trial, temptation, problems, Satan wants you to think that's your giant. God is our giant. That being said, there's only one giant. Fear will say, this is what fear does. It says, look how much bigger that giant is than I am. Look how much bigger it is. Look, this tribulation or trial or temptation or problem is huge. And I'm just me. That's what fear says. What does faith say? Faith says, look how much smaller that giant is than this giant. A rumble in the jungle, so to speak, is about ready to happen. It's on. Saul says, may God be with you, right? Go ahead, right? Well, you could say it's the rally in the valley. Everybody's placing their bet. Everybody's wondering, what is going to happen here? Who is betting on David? Not the Philistines. They're not going to bet on David. What about the Israelites? They're not even betting on David. Everybody's putting their money on Goliath. David is putting everything on who? Everyone's putting money on Goliath. David's putting everything he's got on
God.
God. It's not about David. This is not about David. You see how the Israelites completely messed up? They didn't even factor in God. Right? All the money is on Goliath because they can't even see God in the field. No faith. Wow. It's happening. David knew something. When you bet on God, you always win. That is why we should always be fearless about God's power. Because it doesn't matter who is against you. Oh. It does not matter who is against you if God is with you.
Amen.
That's the second thing we learn. God's power. Right? Presence and His power. Now we're going to talk about being fervent on God's praise. Here we go. One thing that both sides were convinced of was that this fight was not going to be very long. They were not going to be watching this fight for more than a short, maybe few minutes. They were convinced this was a tornado that was about to take down a toothpick. That's what they thought, because of David. I've heard it as an 18-wheeler that was about to run over a mini bike. That's what they would have compared this fight to. A bulldog that was about to eat a baby gator. The Philistines couldn't wait. And the Israelites couldn't watch. The Philistines had their cell phones, right? If you were to imagine them, if it was, you know, current, they'd be, you know, taking pictures and trying to video it. And the Israelites had their blindfolds on. Oh, man.
This is going to be so embarrassing.
That's what it was like for them. Everybody was wondering, what will David's last words be? What is his last words? They, guess what? They weren't his last. But they were some of the best words we ever heard from David. David said to the Philistine, "You come against me with sword and spear and javelin, but I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you've defied. The day the Lord will deliver you into my hands, the Lord will do it," he said, "and I'll strike you down and cut off your head. This very day I will give the carcass of the Philistine army to the birds and the wild animals, and the whole world will know that there is a God." All those gathered here will know that it is not by sword or spear that the Lord saves. This is what he said. These are David's words. "For the battle is the Lord's, and he will give all of you into our hands." Those are David's words. David wants everyone to know. He wants you to know. This is not about David. This is about God. He's not doing this for fame or fortune or what he can get. He's doing it for whose glory?
God's
glory. God. Fighting in the name of God. And he will be delivered by whose power? By God's power. Amen. The battle was not David's. It was God's battle. And they didn't see it. God's own people. Probably the most famous story in the Bible. I believe it's the most misunderstood, forgotten story. The details This story is not about a giant. It's not. But a story about the giant being God. It's not a story about a boy who kills a giant for God. It's about God killing the giant for the boy. God doing it. God was the warrior. God gets the glory. It's not a story about the giants we face. It is a story about the God who fights the giants you face. Are you getting that? If you're watching? This is a story about a God who fights the giants you face. Or are you seeing the giants too big? And maybe you don't see God. Maybe you need to get to know God a little better. Could be the case. Think about it. You got a giant wearing a bulletproof vest, Kevlar helmet, steel-toed boots. His sword is taller than David. His shield weighs more than David. And all that David has is 5 rocks and a slingshot. To be honest, who would you bet on? Be honest. Who would you bet on? Well, if it was a Hollywood movie, and it has been made into a Hollywood movie, check out what the scripture says. As the Philistine moved closer to attack, David ran quickly toward the battle line to meet him, reaches into his bag, takes out a stone, he slung it, and struck the Philistine on the forehead. The stone sank into his forehead, and he fell down on the ground. Remember David's last words? For the battle is the Lord's, and he will give all of you into his hands. Into our hands. David was not fighting for God. God, right, was fighting for David. David was not, you know, in this battle for God. That you're not in these, facing these challenges for God. You're not trying to prove anything. These are challenges you have in your life. God does what? God fights these battles for you. David wasn't fighting God's battle. God was fighting his battle, and he will fight your battle. That's what I want to say. Let me tell you a little secret. That fight, in that valley, it was fixed. That was a fixed fight. Goliath never had a chance. Because Goliath wasn't fighting David. Goliath wasn't fighting David. Goliath didn't have a chance. Who was Goliath fighting?
God.
Goliath didn't have a chance. He was fighting God. David didn't kill Goliath for God. God killed Goliath through David. David got the victory, but God got the what?
Glory.
Glory. God got the praise and the glory and the honor. And that is all David cared about. And that is why he was a man after God's heart. We're just about done with this. I just want to make a couple more points to you. We apply this. Now don't miss this. Don't miss this. I want you to think about this. If you had killed a giant, if you had killed a giant like that, and you were involved, how many times would you tell the story?
A lot.
Would you ever stop telling the story about a giant? That's how we think, but that's not how David thought. Don't miss this. For the rest of David's life, for the rest of his life. And we read about, David wrote a lot of stuff in the Bible, right? A lot of Psalms. Did he ever brag about killing Goliath?
No.
Never did. Did he ever autograph some books, you know, sign them? Hey, the giant killer, that's me. Right? Never. That wasn't what David was about. 1 Samuel chapter 17 and verse 46 says, "And the whole world will know that there is a God in Israel." David's focus was on God's presence. He was fearless in God's power, right? The presence we talked about. He knew God's power. He was fearless. He had faith. And he fervently praised God. And that brings us to an even more deeper truth. This story is not about a little shepherd that beat a big giant. It's not primarily a story about David or Goliath, or even you and me. It's a story about God. David wants us to know there is a God that saves and a God that delivers. There is a God that rescues. This story, it's not a story about a shepherd. It's a story about a Savior. It's a story about Jesus. You'll see how this story goes right along with the story about Jesus. Have you ever thought about this? The fact that David was born in Bethlehem and so was Jesus? David was a shepherd, and what was Jesus? A shepherd, right? The good shepherd. The giant tainted Israel twice a day for how many days? 40 days? Jesus was tempted by the devil how many days? 40 days? The only one who could face the giant that day was David, the ancestor of who? Jesus. The only one that could face Satan was who? Jesus, the son of David. 1,000 years later, Jesus would face two giants, Satan and sin. He too would kneel down for the battle. But instead of picking up a stone, he picks up what? A cross. Right? Where David lived, Jesus died. But where David later died, Jesus rose from the dead, never to die again. The first David needed God to defeat his giant foe. The first David. The second David was God, who has defeated our giants for us. Is a figure of David. The first David never shed a drop of blood and never got a scratch on his body. The second David, or Jesus, shed his blood and was bruised and battered beyond recognition. The first David died into dust. The second David, Jesus, died and came back from the dead, never to die again. And because of him, we don't have to run from giants. We don't have to run from giants because we have a giant that is with us always, and that is God. A God who is for us and who is bigger than any giant you face. Amen?
Amen.
Okay. That's our message.